This is Friday evening's Undercard. On our wrestling show today, we talk to Ohio Valley Wrestling heavyweight champion Tony Gunn about taking down the monster Abyss, how he got into professional wrestling, and his advice to aspiring professionals. Welcome, everyone, to this episode of Friday Evening's Undercard. I'm Gentleman John, he's Electrifying Eric. We're your hosts, and we have a special guest on the show today. He recently became the 23rd Ohio Valley Wrestling Triple Crown Champion, joining names like CM Punk and Cody Rhodes on that distinguished list. He's been a professional wrestler for 15 years, and on the February 2nd, 2019 episode of Ohio Valley Wrestling Television, he conquered the monster and climbed to the mountaintop of Ohio Valley Wrestling. He can be found on Instagram at Tony B. Gunn, on Twitter at Gunn, that's G-U-N-N underscore Tony, and you can find him on YouTube by searching for Tony Gunn. He is the Ohio Valley Wrestling Heavyweight Champion. Ladies and gentlemen, Shotgun Tony Gunn.
Welcome to the Gunn Show!
Show the Ohio Valley Wrestling heavyweight champion Tony Gunn. How are you doing?
Glad to be here. Thanks for having me on.
Great to have you. All right, well, let's start it off. Tell us about that match where you took down Abyss for the championship.
Yeah, that was a little over a week ago, last Wednesday, and it was such a cool and surreal moment. Not only, you know, I took down the Monster Abyss and gained the OVW Heavyweight Championship, but I was in the ring that night for 25 plus minutes. I came out, had a promo with Adam Revolver, and then Adam weaseled his way into a number one contendership, and I ended up having a match with him earlier that night. And then after I went over on Adam, Abyss decided to come out and jump me from behind and declare that our match start right then and there, which I was already down and out from being beat up by Adam. So it was a typical David and Goliath story where I was just fighting from underneath, trying to gain some ground and some momentum. But it was such a cool experience and a frightening experience at that too, being in there with Abyss, because he's such a beast, he's a monster. But you know, after he gave me that second choke slam, I thought it was over. But then he picked me up for that third one, and I knocked his hands away and delivered that kill shot, you know, right to his face, and he fell like a ton of bricks. Such a cool moment, man. Such a cool moment.
And then you had that really cool moment after the match where the locker room cleared out and they got you up on the shoulders.
And that I had no idea that was going to happen. So like I was busy selling the match and selling what happened to me and getting beat up and just trying to lift the title up when the ref gave it to me. And when everybody came out, it was such a surreal moment where, you know, they came out and genuinely cared that I became the heavyweight champion and knocked down the monster. But yeah, it was so cool, you know, just being out there with all the other OVW talent. They show a lot of respect towards me, which is cool. And then Dean Hill came out at the very end and, you know, offered the handshake and the hug of approval, because he's seen, you know, Dean Hill has seen, he's been there since day one, and he's seen every OVW heavyweight champion come through there. So just for him to be there for that moment was really, really special to me.
That's awesome. He came out to congratulate you like that.
Yeah.
And you ended up having to wrestle on Saturday night at the Saturday Night Special, right?
Yeah, I did. And I actually wrestled at a live event the night before, too, against Jay Bradley. That was over in Indiana. Ended up defeating Jay as well too. But yeah, Saturday night at the Saturday Night Special, I was involved in a tag match. It was me and Tony Vannetti against Adam Revolver and Shannon the Dude, which is a good he's a good radio mouthpiece. And the stipulation of that match was if Revolver and Dude won, then Adam would get a shot, you know, at the heavyweight title. And then if we won, which we did, Vanetti would get a shot at Shannon the Dude's radio heavyweight title, that make-believe title that dude loves and cherishes, which is so funny. But that match is actually going to happen tomorrow night at Baptist Performance Center here in Louisville, Kentucky.
Okay, and that's Friday cool. night. Yeah. So actually tonight when this podcast released. And that match was originally supposed to be Revolver wrestling for your number one contender spot and the same stipulations with the radio championship.
Yeah, same stipulation. And then what changed was, it was supposed to be for the number one contender spot. And then the match came about with me and Abyss. So somehow that got finagled to where we had to have our number one contender match before I fought Abyss. So that's where I was kind of, I had my hands tied, so to speak, and I had to have that match with Adam. I had Abyss right after that, which that was a week ago. So that's how that played out.
Yeah, I really thought they did a great job in how they presented the show and how they put you over like they did. Because that was your first win for the heavyweight championship, correct?
Yeah, and to be like, I've been involved with the sport of professional wrestling for a little over 15 years, with Ohio Valley for about 7 years now, and this is my first number one contendership for the heavyweight title ever, which is kind of cool. And then, my first time winning the actual heavyweight title. So, you're exactly right.
And I feel sure that you know this, but that makes you an Ohio Valley Triple Crown champion.
It didn't dawn on me at the time until someone said it. I was like, oh, you're right. Because, I won the tag titles, three-time TV champ, and now the Ohio Valley Wrestling heavyweight champion. Yeah.
Okay, very cool. You said you'd been in wrestling for 15 years. Walk us through sort of how you got into wrestling and how that led you to now Louisville, Kentucky and Ohio Valley.
Yeah, that's a long story. Just like any kid, I loved watching wrestling when I was a little kid. And then for some reason, I kind of fell out of it. I loved the Hulk Hogan, Ultimate Warrior, the Bushwhackers, they were awesome. And then for some reason I fell out. I can't remember. I don't know why. Maybe I got too cool for it or something. But then I picked back up around about 1997, 98, somewhere around there. I was a ninth grader in high school. And my buddies at the time, they were really big into wrestling. They're like, hey, you should watch this. I was like, I don't even know what this is. And I turned on, that was the Attitude Era, Stone Cold, The Rock, Mankind, Chris Jericho, all that stuff. And I was like, what is this? This is amazing, And I kind of fell in love with it. And then, I come from a small town in Rector, Arkansas, 2,017 people. And out of my group of friends, I'm the only one that had a satellite to order the pay-per-views. So every month, my buddies, they would, chip in $5-$10 or whatever to pay for the pay-per-view, and they could come over on Sunday. And, at that time, it was $50, $55, $60 for a pay-per-view. So they would all chip in for that, and we'd watch it. And then somehow we got the broad idea. It's like, hey, let's come out early to my house, and then let's wrestle, like any stupid teenager would. And then we got my mattress, my sister's mattress, the spare bedroom mattress. We put it in the basement, and we just had matches like a few hours before the show, just going down there and beating each other up. And then I had the bright idea. I was like, hey, let's graduate to the garage. So then we did our makeshift ring in the garage. We set up commentary table. We made our own belts out of cardboard. our backyard wrestling company name was DHW, Down Home Wrestling. We did that for a few months, and then it's like, hey, let's build a ring. So I talked to my dad and my mom, and we built a ring and made it out of what we use. We used like logs for like the ring post and box springs for the platform and wood and padding and all that stuff. Ropes were like garden hose and cable. I mean, it was a legit thing. Like you could do springboards and stuff off the ropes. It was crazy. But we didn't do any of that crazy stuff where it's like cheese grater to the head or any of that bogus crap. We actually like studied the moves and went out there and practiced and went through drills, like bump drills, like hip toss and body slam and practice suplexes and all that stuff. But anyways, long story short, that was about 10th or 11th grade. They kind of, you know, grew out of it. And I was the kid that never grew out of it. And at the time, this was about 2000, 2001. And this is back when Memphis Championship Wrestling was developmental for the WWF or WWE now. I don't know if you remember that.
So back then, I didn't know a lot about the developmental system.
Yeah.
I got back into wrestling much the same as you, right there in the mid-1997 time period. It's just for probably the first 6 or 8 months, I was actually more WCW. And then they ran that 1998 Royal Rumble where Steve Austin won it. And then, you know, I almost never watched WCW after that. And so that is actually something I was going to ask. We'll go back to the Memphis Championship.
Okay.
You were a WWF guy, not a WCW guy?
Yeah, like some of my buddies watched WCW because like Goldberg and Sting, and I think Macho was there at the time. But I didn't really, I don't know, for some reason, like as a kid, like I started watching WWF or WWE, whatever you want to call it. And I fell in love with that. Then I tuned into WCW and I was like, this looks totally different than WWF. As far as the production value, like WWE looks so much cleaner and so much more crisp, and WCW looked more, it didn't look as crisp as WWE did. So I was like, I'm not going to watch that. You know, I didn't care about I didn't know the wrestler, so I didn't care about them, but I was a WWE guy, you know, WWE kid. But yeah, but anyways, back to Memphis Championship Wrestling. Like, I mean, as a kid, I didn't know that was developmental territory either. I just knew of MCW and, you know, they were developmental for WWE. And it was 2001, my senior year. I remember my girlfriend at the time, she surprised me with tickets to go to this MCW show, this big show in Jonesboro, Arkansas. And the main event of the night was Triple H against Kurt Angle. Kurt Angle was the heavyweight champ at the time, back when Kurt Angle still had hair. And I just remember being at that show, I sat third row, and just watching the show. I remember Jerry Lawler was on the show, Bill Dundee, the Cat, Victoria, Daniel Bryan, Spanky, a few others that I can't remember off the top of my head. But like I said, the main event was Triple H and Kurt Angle. And I just remember after the show, I said to myself, I was like, I want to do this. Like, just like a lightning bolt hit me. And I was like, I want to do this. I want to try this. You know, I want to be a wrestler. And then after I graduated high school, I started college because, you know, parents say you need to go to college. So I started college, and then I contacted Memphis Championship Wrestling and talked to them about training and all that good stuff. And we'll get to this in a second, but I have a bad history with the developmental system. I think I jinxed them all, because right when I was about to start, I think Terry Golden owned it at the time, and I paid X amount of dollars to start the beginners class. And right when class was going to start, I think the week before or something like that, WWE pulled out, developmental system shut down, and they sent everybody to Louisville, Kentucky with OVW. So I just paid like, I think $1,000 for the beginner's class or something. And now I'm up a creek without a paddle, because MCW, they said, okay, we're done. They closed their doors. So now I paid all this money and I have nowhere to train. But anyways, long story short, another wrestler that lived close by, that was with Memphis Wrestling, he kind of trained me. His name was Biddy Little. I had about 7 to 8 months of training with him. And then I started, you know, wrestling. I had my first match, which was god awful. My first match was in Dyersburg, Tennessee. against, it was a tag match. It was me and Johnny Jeter against two local guys, Tyler Gates and Chris Rocker. And Johnny Jeter just started at the time too, I think. He was with OVW, but he came down to Tennessee for some reason. Him and Nick Densmore and Prototype, which was John Cena, they were all there. But that was like Jeter's first match as well too, which is kind of cool. But that match, I just remember it was garbage. But anyways, I finished my college. I was like, okay, the developmental system shut down. I'm just going to wrestle on the indie scene, learn my craft a little bit, get some experience, you know, under my belt. And then as soon as I graduated college, I was like, okay, I'm going to move to Louisville and I'm going to train under Rip Rogers with Ohio Valley Wrestling. Well, I call up Rip, send him some tapes. He's like, cool kid. Who trained you, by the way? And I was like, well, Derek King took me under his wing and helped me, you know, down the road. He's like, oh, Derek King trained you. He's like, I'm going to have to retrain you then. Just joking, because Derek is, do you know who Derek King is?
I don't.
Okay. He was with OVW back in the developmental days. He was one of the Suicide Blondes. It was him and Jason Lee. They had like bleach blonde hair and stuff. But anyways, I saved money. I moved to Louisville, Kentucky. This was like 2005 or six. Some, I forget, my years are a little off. And then I go to pay Rip. I don't end up paying them, but before class, they shut down as well. And they sent everybody to Florida, Florida Championship Wrestling. And I was like, what the crap is going on with me in the developmental system? Wherever I go, they shut down. So I was like, screw this. I'm not moving to Florida. I'm just going to stick it out here and see what happens. So anyways, long story short, I took a few years off just to kind of regroup and recollect myself. And then I joined back with Ohio Valley 2012, I believe. And I've kind of been there ever since.
That's really cool. Yeah. So you talked about starting off basically in your basement and then the garage and then the backyard. Did you or anyone else that you were doing the training with, did you compete in any other sports, any other combat sports, wrestling, any martial arts, boxing, that sort of thing?
Well, like in the South, like especially in Arkansas, wrestling really isn't that big in that area. I wish they had it, because I think that's something that I would have enjoyed and would have been good at, but no, they didn't have that. But yeah, I did do other sports, and all my friends as well too that chipped in and wrestled and all that, they were involved with sports as well, whether it was basketball or football or track or tennis or golf, baseball, whatever. I kind of did them all. I did football, basketball, baseball, tennis. I did track. So I was kind of busy and heavily involved with sports because that's what I loved. And that's what I went to college for too, is to be a teacher, a PE teacher, because, you know, I love that field.
And that's, yeah. You do that now professionally outside of OVW?
Yeah. So teacher by day right now and wrestler by night. Yeah. So I've been teaching for about 10 years now, and I love it. The kids are great, and I love showing them and teaching them, you know, new things.
Excellent. And you sent me a message a couple of days ago, and you said it was the Triple H versus Kurt Angle match.
Right.
That had you basically like, this is what I want to do. I want to be a wrestler. So right. Walk us through that match a little bit. Like, what was it about the match and the surroundings of it?
You know, I don't think it was so much the match, but I think it was just the overall show and the overall experience and just the feel and the energy of the crowd. Like, that was my first time going to an event like that. And just, like, I remember sitting back. I was third row watching that match and just listening to the crowd and listening to everybody and me myself going crazy. I was like, the energy in here is crazy. I was like, I want this. I want to be the reason why this energy is happening. And it just like a, you know, like I said, a lightning bolt hit. And I was like, man, I was like, I want to do this. I want to do this. But just watching Triple H and Kurt Angle, though, like, you know, obviously I knew who they were because, you know, I was watching WWE. But just watching them perform in the ring, you know, Kurt Angle, which is one of the reasons why I got into professional wrestling, is because I love how great he is in the ring and his charisma. Just watching him in the ring was just so awesome and surreal to me. And Triple H as well, too. Like, he's awesome and great at psychology and storytelling. But just watching that match, like I said, and just the energy and the electricity and just the feeling that I had Like that, it was just like, man, I want to do this. I want to be a wrestler. And I, to be honest with you, I can't even really remember the match itself. I think a DQ ended up happening or something where some people ran out. And I think one of them was like Daniel Bryan and the other one was Spanky. And I don't know, I can't remember who the other one or two were, but anyways. But yeah, that's about it for that. It was so awesome.
It's interesting that you mentioned the energy in the crowd, because when I watched the Ohio Valley episode where you won the championship, that was probably the hottest crowd that I can remember seeing on OVW television.
Yeah, I think, and I'm not going to agree with you just because I was in the ring and that's why it happened. But I can agree with you, because listening to the crowd and watching it back and listening back, I was like, man, that crowd was, they wanted that. They wanted that title change. And I think, I could be wrong, but I think the crowd wanted me to be a champion long before they even knew it, or long before they wanted Abyss to lose it. Because I think it's been, a lot of people said it's been a long time coming. You've earned this, or you've deserved this. But my thing is, I don't think like you deserve anything. I think it's what you've earned through what you do. Just because you've been in wrestling for 10, 15 years doesn't mean you should have this. It's about earning it. And I think I've earned it, not just with the storyline of being the number one contender and all that. It's, you know, I bust my butt in the ring. I bust my butt outside the ring, in the gym, you know, working on promos, this and that, because that's what professionals do. They want to perform. They want to be better. They want to do better. They want to excel. And I think the people see that, and they see that in me, and they know that. So I think that energy came, like you said, that energy was there, and it's the hottest crowd that, as far as, you know, their energy has been in a long time. And I think that's the reason why, because they believe.
Yeah. So I have not been a really long-term viewer of OVW. Uh-huh. If I'm being honest, I had completely forgotten about OVW after they lost the developmental deal, until I read the report that Al Snow had taken over ownership. And then I was like, oh, well, that's cool. Let me see if I can look those guys up and start watching. And I remember seeing you come out for some of those matches when I started watching, and I think that was like episode 973 or something. And shortly after that, they started with that big, long build to episode 1,000.
1,000, yeah.
And I remember seeing you come out, and I was like, that guy looks like a wrestler. Mm. Like, he really looks like a pro, almost like a Nick Aldis type.
Yeah,
coming out of the curtain.
Yeah, I appreciate that compliment. That's awesome. I mean, and you know, to be the part, you got to look the part. And I preach that to all the boys as well too, in the back. Like, you need to start busting your butt and looking like something, and looking like an athlete, look like a competitor, you know, look like a wrestler. Because if you don't believe in yourself or what you do, how do you expect anybody else to? You know, if you don't look the part, you're not the part, they're not going to believe in you. So, but back to like, you know, like you said about when Danny Davis owned it and when WWE pulled out, I can agree with you there. I think a lot of people forgot about Ohio Valley Wrestling as well too, after WWF left, which kind of sucks. But I do want to say this for Danny, which I love him. He's awesome. And he's a fighter as well too. Like, OVW is the only developmental company that was developmental, you know, it's still around. Memphis Championship Wrestling, they closed their doors as soon as WWE pulled out. When WWE pulled out OVW, Danny stuck around. Everybody went to Florida. As soon as Florida Championship Wrestling shut down and they turned it into the Performance Center in NXT, what happened with FCW? They closed their doors as well too. So I give props to Danny for keeping OVW alive this many years. You know, when did that shut down? Back in 2006, I think, or 2005. I give Danny props for keeping OVW alive all those years after WWE pulled out. That's amazing in itself.
So
and sorry to cut you off, and to stay continually on TV after that too. Like you said, we're past 1,000. We're at 1,017, I believe. I think we are the longest running weekly wrestling TV show in history.
Certainly not produced by WWE.
Yeah. Independent. I mean, I'm sorry.
Yeah, but Ring of Honor or none of those guys have been on anywhere close to that.
Yeah.
So two questions related to the wrestling there. I was talking to some people, and we were looking at live wrestling events around the country.
Yeah.
And basically, Louisville, Kentucky, and the surrounding area is pretty much the only place in America now that has regular weekly wrestling. Between OVW and the promotions across the river in Indiana, we counted that there were 170 individual shows in 2018.
Just in Kentucky.
In the Louisville metro area.
Louisville metro area.
So what do you think it is about that area that allows for that to be the case, for there to be that many sustainable wrestling shows in one area?
To be honest with you, I really don't know the answer to that question, but I'll give my opinion. This area, the southern area, it's still kind of old school with the tradition of wrestling and the tradition of storytelling in the ring. It's not so much high spots and leap of faiths and, you know, and all that. We still try to tell compelling stories in the ring, and it still has that old school feel. I think they keep a lot of their tradition, because back when it was, you know, territorial areas, they didn't run once a month. They ran every week and a few shows a week. So I think they still have that old school psychology as far as we need to run on a weekly basis to stay relevant. We need to run every week to keep our fan base. So I think that's the reason why. I mean, I could be totally wrong on that, but that, you know, that's my opinion on that.
And I think you make a good point there, because I wish I lived somewhere that there was weekly wrestling that I could go see, because I don't. Like, I live in Virginia, and like, we don't have anything here. Maybe once a quarter somebody will run a show.
Oh, really?
You know, in an armory somewhere, and that's it.
Yeah, really. Oh, wow. Yeah, because I know a lot of companies, they run, you know, once a month, and it's easier. I guess it's easier on the promoter and the booker to build that show and push that show when you're running once a month, and you might get good crowds by that. But it's like, I give it up to these people that are running every week and running good quality shows at that. I'm not talking about the other promotions out there that are doing it just, you know, as their playground. I'm talking about legit companies out there that are running on a weekly basis and running solid shows. Like, I give props to them, you know, including OVW, because it's hard. It's hard to put on a show, just one show, let alone every single week. And especially if you're doing storytelling with that, like TV, like writing every week, man, that that's like a writing nightmare.
Yeah, for sure. And obviously not just the weekly shows. You run the Saturday night shows once a month.
And right.
You've recently expanded pretty much to a once a month Friday show as well, right?
Yeah, we're in the process of growing right now, because like you said, Al took over ownership of OVW, I think about 6 months now, maybe 8 months. I forget the timeline, but somewhere around there. But he's slowly learning and adjusting as well. And now we're just trying to grow and reach out a little bit as far as doing more events, because, you know, the boys need it as well, too, to get that experience under the belts, more time in the ring. You know, the better you're going to get, besides just our training. So, yeah, we are trying to grow, working those Friday events and creating some more live events as well, too, you know, reaching out a little bit and kind of spreading our wings and getting our name out there.
Right. So you touched on it there, and I don't know how much more you might have to add, but how did the company change when Al Snow bought the company from Danny Davis?
You know, just like anything in life, you know, everybody hates change. You know, whether it's good or bad. If it's good, it takes you a little bit to see it. But the change has been good. The change has been awesome. Al has a great mind for the business. I don't know if you've ever talked to him or listened to any of his podcasts or interviews that he's had. But his mind is awesome for the business, very intelligent, very smart. His psychology is awesome, and he knows how to break it down to where he can, to where you can understand it as far as learning the psychology and the reason behind doing stuff. So having Al own the company and be involved with the company is a true blessing, and it's going to make OVW better in the long run. But at first, all the talent didn't know how to take it at first because they were all used to Danny Davis, and that's all they knew. But to be fair, Danny Davis has been kind of ready to go for the past, you know, 3 or 4 years now, as far as, you know, selling OVW. But the change has been for the better, and it's just getting better and better. And I think if you watched OVW before Al Snow, and then you watch it now, you can see how the show has evolved a little bit as far as storytelling and things of that nature, and as far as characters as well too, and ring psychology. Like, it's a slow process. It's going to be a long process, but I think one of these days down the road, OVW is going to, it's going to be a big show. It's going to be a big thing.
Yeah, I've certainly noticed a change in watching from April or May, whenever it was that he took over, on through to now. I feel like it's a lot better of a product there.
Yeah, and working for Al Snow is awesome. Like, there's three wrestlers that got me into professional wrestling. And like I said, I watched it from the Attitude Era. That was Kurt Angle, which I already mentioned, and Ken Shamrock, because I loved his character and I loved his MMA background. And then the third person was, believe it or not, Al Snow. Those were the three guys that was like, man, this is so cool. I want to get into wrestling. You know, Kurt Angle because of his charisma and his in-ring performance. Like I said, Ken Shamrock because of his style and what he does in the ring. And then Al Snow, I was like, here's this crazy guy that bumps himself on tables and puts himself through stuff and carries a freaking head to the ring and gets it over. You know, the crowd loves it. I'm like, that was just so cool to me as a kid. I was like, that character stuck in my mind along with the other two. So it's so cool. It's so cool to be working with Al Snow, and he's helped me tremendously over the past few years. So as far as my knowledge in the ring and my understanding of psychology and my in-ring work, I give all credit to Al Snow for helping me and guiding me.
So to shift gears a little bit, to go back to something that you'd mentioned earlier, sure, where you talked to some of the guys in the locker room about working on their image and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Apart from guys like Tommy Dreamer and Abyss, are you one of the most senior wrestlers working at OVW right now?
I hate saying that, but yes. Yeah, I am. I'm everybody calls me the vet in the locker room, daddy or dad or father or whatever, you know, just joking around. But yeah, I am the senior in the locker room, the vet. And that's something that I don't take that lightly either. You know, I take it serious because the boys kind of, you know, they kind of look up to you, when you have that experience. And it's not just wrestling experience, not just your years experience, it's what you've experienced along the way, what makes you who you are. And, you know, and I treat them with respect, and I try to help them and guide them as well too, especially if they want it and ask for it. I try to give my, you know, my opinion, my knowledge, and share it with them as well too. And I think they respect that, or at least they act like they do anyways.
Yeah. I know how that goes. I sometimes end up being one of the older people in my workplace. All right. Well, we've got three quick questions for you.
Sure.
Who was your favorite wrestler as a kid?
Favorite wrestler as a kid. Man, like when I very first started watching wrestling when I was a little kid, you know, I'm going to have to say either Ultimate Warrior or Hulk Hogan. You know, they were the big, larger-than-life baby faces at the time. And, yeah, I would say those two because, man, they were larger in life and you wanted to be them, you know. So I would say those two, Warrior and Hogan. But toward to 97, 98, where I really got involved with wrestling, you know, Rock and Stone Cold, obviously they were awesome. But like I said, I think out of the three names that I named earlier, Ken Shamrock, Kurt Angle, and Al Snow, I would have to say Kurt Angle was like my biggest influence and one of the biggest wrestlers that I enjoyed watching in the ring and outside the ring. And I loved everything that he did as a wrestler and as a performer.
Outstanding.
Yeah.
Second question.
Sure.
Who is your favorite wrestler to work with?
Oh, that's a hard one. I've worked with a lot of known names. I'll name a few, just so you know. I mean, because I started in the Memphis, Tennessee area with Memphis Wrestling back when Lawler picked up his TV in that area. So I worked with Jerry Lawler. I used to tag with Bill Dundee. I've worked Coco Beware, Viscera, Sermo, Rodney Mack. I've worked Bobby Eaton several times. He is so easy in the ring, and I love Bobby Eaton. Man, he's amazing. I've worked with Jeter, Mike Mondo. I'm trying to think who else. Dreamer Abyss. And there's a few others that I can't remember because it's been 15 years. But, man, it's hard to say, really. But I would say, just because it's so recent and just because it's such a pivotal moment for me, I would say Abyss, just being in the ring with him, because he just became an Impact Hall of Famer, and he's a known name, and he was so much fun and so easy in the ring and such a cool dude, such a cool guy. So I would have to say Abyss, just because of the experience that happened from that, from becoming the heavyweight champion and moving my journey forward in wrestling. So I would have to say that.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Final question.
Sure.
And it excludes Abyss.
Okay.
You can't use the match that you just had. If you had one dream match, who would it be against and where?
Oh, man. That's something I haven't really thought about. It would be a dream of mine to wrestle Kurt Angle or Ken Shamrock. To be in the ring with them would be amazing, because I think I could go toe to toe with Kurt Angle and Ken Shamrock. And just because I idolized them as a kid, it would be surreal for me to have a match with them. But I would say I will be on the WWE roster sometime. So I would say that's my dream, is to be on that roster, to be on SmackDown or Raw, and to perform in front of that audience. That's what I want. That's my dream. So, yeah, that's my answer.
Outstanding.
Yeah.
Well, right now you are working with the Ohio Valley Wrestling Heavyweight Championship.
Mm-hmm.
And you touched on this quite a bit, but what does the immediate future hold for Tony Gunn?
I don't know. You never know what the future holds. But I know right now I'm going to do everything that I can to bring legitimacy back to this title. And I think, in my honest opinion, and I could be wrong, but I feel like that's something that's been missing from OVW and this title as well. You know, I want to bring back honor, respect, and competition back to this title. You know, I think to be a heavyweight champion, you have to honor that and its tradition. And you also have to respect that. And you also have to compete. And, you know, and that's exactly what I'm going to do. You know, I'm going to welcome all talent, OVW, the big stage WWE, everything in between, Ring of Honor, Impact Wrestling, the newly AEW. I don't care if anybody wants to step in the ring with me. You know where I am, Louisville, Kentucky, every single week. They can come and find me. So that's that. And then I personally want to help the company grow as well, too. I want to see OVW and evolve into something great, into something big, into something where it's like OVW is a name that everybody knows. And I do want to, sorry to cut you off. I do want to talk about OVW for a second as far as the school. There's something rolling out soon with Ohio Valley Wrestling, and Al Snow is doing all this, which is great. I don't want to say what it is because I'm going to let them announce this, but it should be happening within the next few months. Ohio Valley Wrestling and the school is going to be doing something that professional wrestling has never done for a training school. And I can't wait till they announce it because I think it's going to be huge. I think it's going to be big. And I think it's going to change the way that people will want to train and view getting into the business.
Okay. So you talked about the Ohio Valley Wrestling School. Tell us a little bit about how someone could get involved with that and what it entails going through the school and how that could benefit somebody that wants to get into professional wrestling.
Sure. I think if you're really serious about wanting to get in this business, wanting to get into professional wrestling, I think you need to take it serious. I mean, there's a lot of schools out there, but I think OVW, you know, it has a name. People know what OVW is. A lot of great talent has come through OVW. A lot of the talent that's in the WWE now. I mean, you have Mike Mondo, Johnny Jeter, Nick Densmore, Brock Lesnar, John Cena, Randy Orton, Batista, the Basham Brothers, Shelton Benjamin. The list goes on and on and on as far as the talent that's come out of OVW. So evidently they've been doing something right. But if you want to be serious about becoming a wrestler, then you need to go to a good quality school. And Ohio Valley Wrestling is that. You know, it's in Louisville, Kentucky. If you want to reach out, you can go to OVWWrestling.com and check it out. There's a beginner's class, an intermediate class, and an advanced class. Rip Rogers, which has a very great mind, and he breaks things down for you. He's a very good trainer, and there's other trainers involved as well. And Al Snow plays a part in that as far as helping out. So, like I said before, he is a brilliant, brilliant mind to have and to learn from. So if you want to become a professional wrestler, a manager, a referee, a valet, work on production, storytelling, writing, whatever, you need to check out Ohio Valley Wrestling.
Very cool. And thanks for the information on that.
Yes.
Well, Tony, as we wrap things up today, is there any parting thoughts you have for the listeners?
I would end on this note. Chase your dreams. Don't listen to what other people say. There's always going to be naysayers out there. There's always going to be haters. There's always going to be people saying you can't do this. And at the end of the day, those people really don't matter in your life. And 9 times out of 10, if you have those people negative in your life, the only reason why they're saying that to you is because they're probably not happy themselves and they don't want to see you happy. So chase your dream, follow your dream, no matter how crazy it is, whether it's in the sport of professional wrestling or whatever it may be, follow your dream and never give up. And that's all I got to say.
And that's some excellent advice from the current Ohio Valley Wrestling heavyweight champion, Tony Gunn. Tony, we appreciate you coming on the podcast today. Best of luck in the future. And hopefully you can hold that title for a very long time.
Hey, I plan on doing it. And just to let you know, this is my very first podcast. So thank you for that.
Well, that's awesome to hear, Tony. Thank you very much for your time. And we'll talk to you again soon.